that you've done for me.
Good morning. Happy Easter. So glad to be worshiping with you guys today. At Foothills, we are an open, affirming community. That means that we welcome everybody, and that means you. So we are so glad that you're here. Just a few things before we get started. We have children's programming. We have Kingdom Kids, which is third through fifth grade, and we have Worship and Wonder, which is preschool up through second grade. In a little bit here, we'll have a children's moment, so all the children are welcome to come up here and participate in that, and then they're welcome to return to sit with their adults or go to the children's programming, and they'll just walk right out the back, and then they'll return at the end of the service. So either way, whatever you want to do, that's fine with us. Once the kids are dismissed, there will be more seating, so if you're looking for a seat, we'll have a little more room. We do have the Easter egg hunt today right after the service. If you didn't bring an Easter basket, we have some extra bags, so don't worry about that. Stay for that. And if you did bring flowers for the cross, you can feel free to add those in as we are singing together. And now I invite you to stand as you're able and join in a call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
For it was on the first day of the week at early dawn
that the stone was rolled away.
For Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
And now, as you're comfortable, please remain standing as we join together in song.
Oh, Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of a Savior.
For the children's moment before Cal gives our prayer. That way, we'll come over here on the steps where our children's moment is.
people.
We went there.
If you're looking for a seat, now's the time.
Okay. Yeah. So very soon, as you can see, we have a lot of empty seats now. And some of the kids might be going back to their parents if they prefer, but a lot of them will be going to our Worship and Wonder and Kingdom kids. So once they leave, I invite you, if you don't have a seat, to fill them in where the empty seats are now. And we're going to do a change of plans. Normally, our kids come back at the very end of the service, but instead, we're going to have the Worship and Wonder teachers and Kingdom Kid teachers to take all the kids to the fellowship hall, where that's where we're going to have the egg hunt right afterwards, where we'll gather. So if you're a parent and you're looking for your child after this, if they go to a class, we'll be over in the next building in the fellowship hall. But that way we can make use of our space. It's such a joy and a delight to have so many of you gathered in worship this morning. Cal, you'll lead us in prayer, and then we'll have our children's moment.
Please join me in prayer. Dear Lord, draw our thoughts upward toward you every minute of every day, but especially this Easter. Help us enjoy the beauty of your creations on this earth. Focus our thoughts to your grace as we join together in worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Right, are you ready for an Easter egg hunt? Anyone bring their Easter basket today? You did? Yes. Well, don't worry, we thought about that too. So we have extra baskets and bags in case you forgot, but I wanted to do a poll this morning. I wanted to see, what is your favorite thing to find in an Easter egg? Is it, if you really like chocolate inside your Easter egg, raise your hand. What about, who likes sweet and sour candy inside their eggs? What about a little tiny toy? And who likes to find money inside their eggs? Whoa. Wonderful. Well, so those are all wonderful things to find in Easter eggs, but this is a real chicken egg. This is what a real egg. So what do you find inside a real egg? Just say it out loud if you know it. Yolk, that's right. So I need one brave volunteer. Okay, are you brave? Okay, come here. All right, so you said there's inside of it? Yolk? Okay, she said she was really brave, so I'm going to crack this on top of her head, okay? Oh, we picked the right person. Okay, are you ready to watch me crack this on top of her head? Okay. And it's a real egg. Doesn't it look like a real egg? You want to help me count down. Count to three with me, okay?
One, 2, 3.
What happened? There is no yolk. It's empty. But it's a real egg, I promise. Doesn't it look like it's real? Well, this is empty. And so that reminds us of the Easter story when the women got up really early and they went to the tomb to go bring oil and spices to Jesus' body. But when they got there, there was nothing inside. Jesus' body wasn't there. It was empty. So hopefully this will help you remember the very special good news of the empty tomb. You can be reminded of the empty egg. All right. What do you know? You want to say? Okay. I want to hear. Wow, you got two visits in one. That's special. All right, well, I'm going to say a prayer, and then you're invited to go to Worship and Wonder or Kingdom Kids or back to your parents or families you came with. Let us pray. Loving God, thank you for all of these wonderful children. We ask that you bless them and look upon them with kindness as we continue to worship you and wonder about you. Amen. All right, you are free to go. You can go to class or back to your family.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth a living just because he lives. God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He bled and died. My Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know is worth a living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy they bring. But greater still, that calm assurance, this child can face uncertain days because he lives. And then one day, I'll cross that river. I'll find life's fine, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know.
Yeah.
Will you join with me in prayer? As we pray, I'll pause once as an opportunity to share our prayer concerns. You can say those aloud or in the silence of your heart or type them in the comments, and I'll pause another time to share praises, and then we'll end together with the Lord's Prayer, which will be up on the screen for you. Loving God, on this Easter, as on that day long ago, you came, steadfast love, continuing to walk with us on this strange pilgrimage of worry, fear, and loss, showing us the good news of the empty tomb, calling us to run and tell everyone of the new life which is ours. On this Easter morning, as on that early first morning, you wait and watch. Gardener of the seeds of love, hope, and grace you planted deep within us, as we stand amazed at the harvest of hope and life which is handed to us this day as you call us by our names. In those early morning moments, Spirit of the brokenhearted friends, you whispered of that love which cannot be held behind the stones of our fears and doubts, of that hope which puts grave clothes into bandages for the hurting, of that grace which turns cartwheels in the gardens of our hearts, even as you whisper them to us. On this Easter, as on every day, your grace, your peace, your love gives us new life and hope. God in community, holy and one, we ask now that you hear our prayers of concern. We thank you for hearing our prayers. We also rejoice in your resurrection this morning, and we ask that you hear our prayers of praise. And together we all pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And I'll be reading a scripture as soon as it pops up. Psalm 118, 1 to 2, 14 to 24. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone of the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Thank you, Cal. The story of Easter morning, the story of Jesus' resurrection, is found in all four Gospels. The one consistency is that there was an empty tomb, but each Gospel has its own details that make them unique. Matthew's Gospel, there's an earthquake. In John's Gospel, it's the one where Mary mistakes Jesus for a gardener. But today we are going to hear from the Gospel of Luke, and there's one line in particular for me that stands out from the rest, and it's only found in this version of Luke's gospel. And it's the question that I invite you to sit with as we hear today's scripture. But the question that gets asked is this: why do you look for the living among the dead? Let us listen for a word of good news from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. It reads, "But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, 'Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again?' Then they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Have you ever wondered what in the world Easter bunnies have to do with Jesus' resurrection? And if there was a bunny that, or an animal that children sat on for this holiday, surely there are other options. Jesus is referred to as a lamb. We could have developed a lamb the size of an adult where children could come up and sit on their seat, but I don't think that would be any less creepy. Or perhaps a chicken would make the most sense because a chicken actually lays eggs. But I think I finally found a connection to why the Easter Bunny makes sense with this pairing of this reading of the story of Easter morning. Because often, or almost all the time, when angels appear in Scripture, people are terrified. Angels come and they say, "Do not be afraid." Now, that phrase isn't in this story, but there are two men, dazzling white, that appear to be angels, and it says the women are terrified. Easter bunnies are terrifying. In case it's been a while since you've seen one, I found a few. There's lots and lots to choose from, but if you can show some Easter bunny pictures, kids always are crying in them. Have you got and there's one. There you go. And even Easter bunnies are terrifying. Angels are terrifying. You can. And so, but when I spent time with this story this morning, not only did I find that the women thought the angels were terrifying, I personally found these two men in dazzling white clothes to be quite rude. The women, they are faithful. They are examples of wonderful faith. When everyone else has departed Jesus, when they've left him behind, even when they said that they want it is the women that remain. And they stay home during Sabbath in their grief after Jesus has died. And as soon as Sabbath ends, the moment of dawn, they get up in their faithful way and they pack their supplies of spices and perfume to anoint Jesus' body because they are faithful. And they make that path to Jesus' tomb on that dusty path where they unite together, these women, disciples of Jesus. And they get there, And they get this question that seems to be scolding. Why do you look for the living among the dead? You've got it all wrong. You are in the wrong place at the wrong time. And maybe I'm a little protective of these women because if we continue in the story, not only are they chastised by these angels, they remain faithful and they follow through with what the angels tell them to do, to go and tell that he is alive. And they go and they find the men, the disciples, who had departed them from Jesus and are separated in fear. And they tell the truth that they have heard. And then these men say, what you are saying is an idle tale. But if we go and look at the Greek, that's kind of a nice way to say what really they've said. The men tell these women, what you say is garbage. And that's the PG version of that word. So they have been chastised. They've been told that they are not to be believed. But perhaps these angels aren't rude. And maybe it's just how that question hit me at first. Because perhaps they are exactly where they're supposed to be. That's where the angels were expecting them. That's where the angels were waiting for them. And so instead of hearing this question as a scolding question, perhaps this question of why do you look for the living among the dead is a prompting question. Because from there, the angels say to them, remember? Remember, be reminded of Jesus' words, what he has told you. He's told you three times that he is going to die and rise again. But when they had heard this news through the Galilean ministry with Jesus spending all the time, it was impossible. They had never gone through such an experience before, so it was hard for them to understand what was going to happen. But it is through their memory of those words and that prompting of that question, why do you look for the living among the dead, that they remember. It's a moment of recognition. Now, I have made it through my Easter goal so far. I am still here. I wasn't sure if it was going to happen or not. I'm a little over 2 weeks from my due date. And this time around, this is my third time to be expecting, and I get the wonderful label of being called advanced maternal age, which is the nicer version of geriatric pregnancy. But I do say that I've learned to appreciate being in this category of extra caution, because as I've come to the end of my pregnancy, it's meant that every week I get to go and have an ultrasound. And I've been seeing these ultrasounds, and I look at them, and to me, all ultrasound babies look like ultrasound babies. But people will always tell me, oh, look, they have this feature and that feature. And I'm sure once I meet my new daughter, I might be able to put the pieces together. But to me, that's kind of what has happened with Jesus and these disciples. He has given them something. He's told them that he's going to die and rise again. But it's not until it happens that they come to this place of recognition and they get to experience resurrection. Because resurrection isn't something we just receive. Resurrection is something we claim. And these women, they get to claim the good news that Jesus is risen, and they get to be the first preachers of the gospel of the good news. Perhaps they were exactly where they were supposed to be. It is by doing that next right thing that they are in the right spot that allows them to witness the glory of the resurrection. We are all invited to claim resurrection, to put together the pieces of memories we've had, to come to this place of living into transformation. And the good news is that you already have everything you need. God has created us in the image of God as children of God, beloved and worthy. There's nothing we need to do to earn this resurrection or this good news or this transformation, but instead we are given it as an invitation to claim it and then to proclaim it and share it with others. Why do we look for the living among the dead? Because that is where resurrection happens. The good news of Easter is that all those places where you thought were hopeless are your places that can spring forth with new life. The good news of Easter is that the worst thing is never the last thing. That hope overcomes fear, that love wins, and joy triumphs over despair. Why do we look for the living among the dead? Because this is the good news of resurrection. My friend Hope, who some of you know is a fellow disciples pastor and one of the first people to befriend me when I moved here to Arizona, but he is full of stories and lived experiences of how he has found the living among the dead. When he was in seminary several decades ago in Lexington Theological Seminary, he took on an internship in the summer where he was hired by an ecumenical group of churches in Kentucky to spend the summer every weekend going to a different county in a different city to lead worship for migrant workers that were there for just the season. And on the last Sunday of doing this, he told me the story about there was this man who said, "Where is your church? I want to keep worshiping with you." He's like, "No, this my internship, it's done, I'm over with." He's like, "Well, if you're free next weekend, it's the anniversary of my wife's passing. Can you lead prayer in the cemetery?" And he didn't really want to, but he said this man was really nice and it was hard to say no to him. So he got up and he went that morning to the cemetery, expecting to meet the man there. But when he got there, there was a crowd of 20 to 30 people, and they prayed, and they sang, and they worshiped. And now, instead of just this one man asking, it was a whole group of people asking, "Where will you be next Sunday? We want to worship again." He had no intention of starting a church, but from that moment in the cemetery, it birthed into him starting a church while in seminary, and it was the first Spanish-speaking congregation in Lexington, Kentucky, that still meets today. He now serves churches here in Arizona, but once again, I've been experienced him, how he has brought life out of death. His congregation was quite small, and many churches in that place may have decided it was time to close the doors. But instead, they decided to sell their property because they had an interested buyer. And instead, they bought a dilapidated Denny's that had been closed for several years. And over the past few years, they have transformed that space into a new worship sanctuary where they gather, and it's a bunch of people who are delightful, who are in their 80s and 90s and are full of vibrant life. I go and join them some weeks on Wednesday for Bible study and sit next to the 90-year-olds who are making sandwiches for those experiencing homelessness. Why do you look for the living among the dead? Because that is the good news of resurrection. The good news of resurrection is that we are Easter people in a Good Friday world where we get to claim this transformation for ourselves and proclaim it to everyone else that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. As we make our way to communion this morning, I'm reminded that not only is this question asked, but it's also given this invitation to remember. And that is exactly what we do when we share together the bread and the cup, we remember. And most often, if we think of an opposite word for remember, it is to forget. But there's another way to think about that. The opposite of remember can also mean to dismember. And that is what has happened just 2 days ago with Jesus on the cross. But now that we are living on this side of resurrection, we are invited to remember not only the stories, but to actually remember, to put back together the body of Christ as a church in all ages and all places. This is a table where everyone is invited to come and receive and taste the good news. We share communion this morning by, we'll be passing trays. If you're new here, they are situated so that when you grab a cup, they're actually double stacked, so the bread is at the bottom cup and the juice is on the top. And as a favor, as we have communion servers that will be down the aisles, but the very middle aisles, if you're on that spot, if you could pass it across the aisle to your neighbor on the other side, it'll help us share that together smoothly. This is a table where everyone is welcome and all are invited. Let us prepare for this meal with our communion song, "Wondrous Cross."
There is a love so sure, nothing it can't endure. There is a life it brings, it's greater than anything. I once was dead within, hollowed by all my sin, lost and so led astray. Your love reached all the way. Your love reached all the way. Oh, the wondrous cross where the Prince of Glory died. Oh, the glorious cross where your mercy bled for us. You
we gather around this table to share the bread and the cup with all who desire to come to this table. And as we take part in the supper, we renew our commitment to live as Christ's resurrected people, to love as Christ loved, to carry his light with us. The table is not for the few, but for the many. It is not our table, but his, and he invites us all to share the supper with him. Because when he was meeting the last time with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and said, "This is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup and said, "This is the blood of my covenant poured out for many. For I tell you that I will not eat or drink of this again until I come anew into my Father's kingdom." Let us pray. Our most merciful God, we thank you for this most glorious and joyful of all days. On this resurrection morning, we come to this table knowing that your Son lives, and because he lives, we have been given meaning for our lives. We take this bread and drink this cup, recounting his suffering and death, but not in sorrow. For we know that this was not the end, but the beginning. Bless this bread and this cup as we renew our commitment and love for you through your Son and our Lord, Jesus our Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
place. I tremble, I must face. I won't be overwhelmed. Jesus, your love has won. My faith looks up to thee.
Some of us are great speakers, and some of us are still working on it, so forgive the notes. I want to thank everyone who helped set up and clean up after that Maundy Thursday dinner. That was terrific, wonderful mood setting there. And there are many ways to share your gifts and talents here at Foothills. I'm not going to list them. Check out the newsletter for opportunities to share those gifts and talents. And here at Foothills, we don't pass an offering plate. If you would like to make a final financial contribution, there's an offering box in the Narthex, and you can also give on the website, Facebook, or by mail.
Thank you, Cal, and thank you for all of your generous gifts. They make our mission and ministry possible and make us have a greater impact in our community and wider world. With it being Easter, there's also a special Easter offering we take up. If you'd like to designate it for that, it goes to support the general ministries of the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ. And just make sure you designate it special offering if you'd like it to go to that versus our regular offering. I will lift up a few things happening in the life of the church, but there's so many that I won't go through them all. But if you were able to get a bulletin, we have a list of so many different things happening, and all of those options are things that are open to anyone, pretty much. And so you're welcome to come to some of those or all or any of it. We, speaking of what's going to be happening today, is after our worship service, we'll be gathering for an egg hunt over in the courtyard, but also in the fellowship hall, there's refreshments, so we'd love for you to linger and stay and visit a while. If you don't have an Easter basket for your child, we have some for you, or we're going to have separate ages groups for the different areas, so look for those instructions, and we'll get started soon after this. But if you are looking for your children, they're going to be over in the fellowship hall, which is the building just next to this labeled such as that. Yesterday, last night, our Lenten auction ended, and we surpassed our goal. So thank you for your generosity for that. All the all those handmade items are going to be available. So if you won something in the auction, you can go into the admin building in the back meeting room. That's where all the items are. And if you need to contribute for what your bid was, you can either write a check or give online, but just make sure you designate it so that we know it goes for that purpose. All the funds raised for that go to our Green Chalice projects around our campus and also the Dilcon chapter of Navajo Nation. Next Sunday, we will be gathering for an Earth Day themed service, and it's going to be a blessing of the animals. So you're invited to come back and bring your pets. We're not going to be in this space. We're going to be out in the courtyard, but we're going to set up the space with lots of shade and hopefully make it through together. But you're invited to either bring your own lawn chair, or we'll have chairs for that as well. But two things I do just want to lift up is that our Vacation Bible School and also our next small group series that's launching called The Art of Neighboring, there's information on your way out for both of those things. It is such a joy to have you in worship this morning to celebrate the good news of Easter. And as part of our worship service, we always end with a call to discipleship. If there's anyone here looking for a new church to call home, we gladly welcome you. If you'd like to come forward and place your membership in our church, we gladly welcome you. You are invited to do that as we stand now and sing and join our voices one last time.
So if I could get the choir to come back up, I'm going rogue. We had another song planned, but the choir did such a great job. We'd like for them to come up and finish off this last song. And we had one rehearsal today, so I think we should give them a round of applause for doing such a wonderful job. I'm going to finish off with a verse and chorus of Christ the Lord is risen today.
Ready to proclaim that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. knowing that the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit is with us now and always. Amen.